Go. All right, I'm going to welcome you all. Good morning, everyone, to the August 30th Men's Club meeting, South Jersey Men's Club. I hope you all had a good week. It's a beautiful day out. We'll have a chance maybe to walk without humidity dripping off our foreheads. In any case, we have with us this morning Elissa Miller Gillston, I think is more proper, Associate Director of Development, Philadelphia, Washington, American Technion Society. And Elissa is going to introduce herself, and she's assisted this morning by Melanie Berger Bray, who will share her screen with us and give us some video and audio. Thank you.
Thank you, and good morning. Thank you so much for having us today. As Ed mentioned, I'm Elissa Miller Gillston with the American Technion Society Philadelphia office, and we serve Eastern Pennsylvania, South Jersey, and Delaware. And with me this morning is my colleague, Melanie Berger Bray, who is our events expert. She'll be sharing her screen in just a moment, and we have a presentation for you this morning about the Technion Israel Institute of Technology, which is Israel's Science and Technology University. And again, we're with the American Technion Society, which is a nonprofit headquartered in New York City with 13 regional offices around the country. We provide philanthropic support to the Technion, which is Israel's university at the center of its economic growth, security, and high-tech prominence. And today, mostly, we'll be discussing the Technion impact, which is the incredible and outsized effect that the Technion has on Israel and the world. So Mel, if you can share your screen, we're going to kick things off with a brief video that was produced by the Ministry of Foreign Affairs about how the Technion is a science powerhouse and a hub for coexistence.
This place is where diseases are cured, Nobel Prizes are won, and the technology that's making the world a better place is made. Welcome to the Technion, Israel Institute of Technology. Founded in 1912, 36 years before Israel's independence, it is one of Israel's oldest and most prestigious universities. One of its pioneers, Albert Einstein himself. 3 Technion professors have won the Nobel Prize in Chemistry. Dan Schechtman discovered something thought impossible, a quasi-crystal.
My research is centered on the structure and properties of metallic materials. Over the years, I have been developing different metallic alloys, and in recent years, magnesium alloys. In the future, we use the wonderful alloys that we have developed over the years and 3D print them to form useful structures.
Avram Hershko and Aaron Chekhanover discovered the control mechanism of the protein in the cell, which is a huge leap for cancer treatment research.
I hope that in the future we shall see also drugs to combat other diseases like Alzheimer's and other neurodegenerative diseases.
Professor Shulamit Levenberg is pioneering stem cell research here at the Technion.
We try to engineer pieces of tissues in the lab, and these pieces of tissue can then be implanted to repair or replace damaged tissues. In the future, we plan to take tissue engineering to its next level. We established the bioprinting center, and we can now print biomaterial and cells to build tissue that can be personalized and large-scale tissue, complex tissue.
Here in Professor Chosam Chayek's laboratory. He has developed nanos, which, upon sampling a patient's breath, can diagnose up to 17 different diseases.
All my life, I have believed in equal opportunity for every life over Earth. And therefore, the next step in our research and development is to enable diagnostic tools that are very cheap, very affordable, that could be delivered to every person.
The Technion is not only a science powerhouse, but it's also an engine for coexistence. Over 20% of the student body are Arabs, the same proportion as there is in the overall Israeli population. Imagine life without fast internet streaming. Well, the Lempel-Zeev algorithm developed by Technion professors finds a way to compress data without losses. Now, that's important when you're streaming your favorite TV show. a century at the Technion, people from all over Israel, all over the world, have joined forces to solve some of humanity's greatest problems. If you care, share.
Thank you. As I mentioned, the Technion impact is the incredible and incomparable effect that the Technion Israel Institute of Technology has had on Israel and the world. From the enrollment of the first class in 1924, the Technion has played a critical role in building and strengthening the modern state of Israel. Its faculty and students are foundational to Israel's technology-focused economy. Moreover, its research labs and classrooms have produced many critical defense and medical technologies and the leaders in these fields as well. The university's first cornerstone was laid in 1912, making it Israel's oldest university. And ever since, the history of Israel itself and the Technion have been intimately linked. In the beginning, the Technion's goal was to provide the technical training to build the roads and the water system that were the basis of the new country. And then the Technion launched the Faculty of Aerospace Engineering, which has trained most of the leaders in Israel's space and defense industries. Next, the Technion Ingenuity helped transform Israel's economy from one based on agriculture to one based on semiconductors. And today, the Technion is the major source of the human capital for Israel's high-tech industries. You can look no further than the Israeli tech sector and economy to see the effect of the Technion impact. More than 70% of Technion alumni are employed in Israel's high-tech workforce. 25% of those alumni are CEOs or vice presidents of their companies. And of the 72 high-tech Israeli companies on the NASDAQ, 42 are led by Technion alumni, and these companies have a market cap of nearly $22 billion. Many Technion scientists or alumni are turning their promising research into new businesses and heading up ventures that drive Israel's economic growth. The student body of more than 13,500 is more diverse than ever. 40% of the student body is female. 20% of the students are Arab, which mirrors the makeup of Israel's Arab community. And interestingly, half of those Arab students are women. The Technion also attracts over 1,000 international students from over 30 countries, and its pre-university programs target promising high school students from underserved communities, including ultra-Orthodox adults who lack a secular education, and prepare them for a Technion education. Of course, students are just part of the picture. The Technion has 565 faculty members with expertise in black holes, cancer research, alternative energy, and more. And I'm just going to highlight a few of our superstar faculty. Professor Marcel Machlouf is the Dean of the Faculty of Biotechnology and Food Engineering. She was recently honored at Israel's 70th Independence Anniversary Ceremony for her pioneering cancer research. In one of her many breakthroughs, she developed the NanoGhost targeted drug delivery system, which could revolutionize brain cancer treatment. Adult stem cells are emptied of their content and they're rendered ghosts, which allows them to pass undetected through the immune system. They're then made tiny enough to pass through the brain's protective barrier and refilled with drugs that can be released at the tumor site and not affecting healthy tissue. Professor Shulamit Levenberg, Dean of the Faculty of Biomedical Engineering, works in tissue engineering, and she's launched a center at the Technion to 3D print cells, tissues, and organs. She also invented the technology to produce the world's first lab-grown steak, now being developed commercially by Aleph Farms. Incidentally, a controversy in Israel is lab-grown steak kosher? The rabbis are working on that. Her startup made headlines when she successfully gave the technology for them to grow meat on the International Space Station for the first time. Professor Hosam Haik has won many coveted awards for his breathalyzer technology and sniff phone that detects 17 different diseases, including various cancers, Parkinson's, and Alzheimer's disease. He's recently adapted this technology to include COVID testing, which I'll talk more about in a bit. Incidentally, Professor Haik is an Arab Israeli. He was recruited to the Technion in an initiative to specifically recruit minority faculty members, and that initiative happens to be funded by a philanthropist right here in Philadelphia. So we're honored to have a personal connection to Professor Haik. As the video mentioned, the Technion is home to three Nobel Prize laureates in science. From left to right, Professor Dan Shechtman won in 2011 for his discovery of a new form of matter called quasicrystals. And this discovery revolutionized the understanding of how atoms arrange themselves in solids. Distinguished professors Aaron Chikanover and Avram Hershko were awarded the Nobel Prize in Chemistry in 2004 for their discovery of the ubiquitin system, the process by which the body destroys proteins that are no longer useful. Their discovery had direct applications to cancer research, including the frontline multiple myeloma drug called Velcade. The Technion is considered a key ingredient in the secret sauce of Israel's success. The Technion fosters entrepreneurship, and 25% of alumni have founded at least one startup. T3 is the Technion transfer arm. Technology transfer arm. It facilitates the passage of new ideas to successful products and companies in world markets. T3 filed an average of 80 to 100 new patent applications every year. And T3 has been the source of historic marketization, including Mazor Robotics, which was acquired by Medtronic in 2018 for $1.7 billion, the biggest ever Israeli biotech acquisition. There are over 2,000 Technion alumni living and working in Silicon Valley, as well as at the world's largest tech companies all over the globe. There happens to be a corporate park right down the road from Technion's campus in Haifa, where Israeli headquarters of Google, Microsoft, Apple, and Intel recruit from campus, and their location is surely not a coincidence. It's very likely that the processor on the computer you may be using right now was developed by Technion graduates working at Intel. If you use a flash drive, the underlying technology was developed by a Technion alumnus. And when computers compress information in photos, PDFs, or GIF videos, that's done using an algorithm developed by Technion professors Abraham Lempel and Jacob Ziv. The Technion is also making headway into emerging computer-related fields of tomorrow, including artificial intelligence, quantum computing, and cybersecurity. The Technion is considered an applied science and research powerhouse. As one of the only technology institutes in the world with its own faculty of medicine, Technion is at the forefront of medical innovations in cancer, neurodegenerative diseases, stem cell research, heart disease, and more. The Technion impact reverberates through the many medical innovations impacting lives anywhere, and some include the SniffPhone that we mentioned earlier, which is the breathalyzer technology combined with a smartphone for the early detection of life-threatening diseases. The PillCam, which is a swallowable camera that traverses the digestive tract to detect polyps and tumors, could replace an invasive colonoscopy. Azelect, a leading drug for Parkinson's disease, and ReWalk, which is an exoskeleton designed by Technion graduate Amit Gopher that enables paraplegics to walk. From Israel's inception, the Technion has helped ensure the safety of its people. The Technion has the only faculty of aerospace engineering in Israel and works closely with the government, the military, and Israel's defense industry. Technion graduates were instrumental in the development of the Iron Dome, the anti-missile defense system that protects Israel by intercepting and destroying rockets before they can take lives and destroy property. And now we're going to watch a brief video about the Iron Dome missile defense system.
My name is Orel Ezra, and I'm from Sderot. That's my grandparents' house in Moshav Shibolim. It's 5 minutes away from Sderot. Moreover, 10,000 rockets fell in Sderot during the last 12 years. On 2006, I think, I used to go to Bnei Akiva when I was younger. It's a youth movement. And after Shabbat, one of my friends, her name is Ella, from some reason left earlier with her young brother, and while they were walking, they hear the alarm. And they were looking for a place, like a safe zone. And they couldn't find any, so Ella was hugging her brother and telling him, don't worry, everything's gonna be okay. And the rocket fell too close to Ella and their brother, and Ella passed away.
Rockets have been fired on Beit She'an, Kiryat Shmona, and Sderot for more than 10 years. The threat has always been there. The threat wasn't born yesterday. The threat has been here always. Advanced technological means allowed us to offer the Defense Forces an affordable interceptor. The Iron Dome system consists of sensors which are designed to identify that an enemy rocket has been fired. The Iron Dome calculates the rocket's predicted hit point. If the rocket is going to hit an unpopulated area, the system won't intercept the rocket. If the rocket is going to hit a populated area, then interception planning is activated. The Iron Dome missile homes in on the enemy rocket, pursues it, approaches it, and explodes it at the precise moment that ensures that the rocket will be destroyed, as well as all the explosive material contained in it.
When the last round of violence broke, we here at Rafael immediately knew that we have a lot of work to do. We felt obligated to do everything we can, day and night, to deploy the new system that will contribute to saving lives of our friends and our colleagues around the country.
I am very proud that the engineers who helped develop the Iron Dome are Technion graduates. It showed me the power of my education at the Technion.
This is where the talents are. This is where the best minds of the evolving generations of engineers are studying.
The majority of the university graduates that Rafael hires are from the Technion, and they are highly professional. We often find ourselves in the situation where a senior Rafael engineer sits in the same room with a young Technion graduate. They complement each other in an amazing way. The senior engineer brings to the table his experience, and the young Technion graduate contributes the latest technological know-how from his Technion studies.
When the system is working operationally and all the world sees it on TV and us amongst everybody else, this is the point where we really know that we made a difference and lives are being saved every day.
To some initiatives related to sustainability. The Technion is behind many of Israel's most innovative technologies for water management, food sustainability, and alternative energy. The University Stephen and Nancy Grand Water Research Institute serves as the Israeli National Institute for Research in the Engineering and Management of Water Resources. Israel, by the way, is one of the most water-secure nations in the world. Scientists at Technion's Nancy and Stephen Grand Technion Energy Program are leading the way on alternative and renewable energy. Technion has a faculty of food engineering and biotechnology, where research could help solve the world's food problems. The Technion is a hub for coexistence and diversity. As I mentioned, female students account for 40% of the student body, and Arab Israeli students are 20% of the student body. Additionally, there's a pre-university program that targets promising high school students from underserved communities, as well as ultra-Orthodox adults lacking a secular education, to prepare them for a Technion education. Pictured is Dr. Yehuda Sabiner, who graduated from Technion's Rappaport Faculty of Medicine to become the first person born and raised in a Haredi community in Israel to become a mainstream doctor. Like most Haredi men, Dr. Sabiner's secular education ended when he was 13 years old. To prepare for medical school, Dr. Sabiner attended the Technion's Mechina, a preparatory program that helps ultra-Orthodox students catch up and pursue higher education. And he now works as an internist serving his own community in Bnei Brak. Today's Technion is a global Technion with a presence in New York City and China. The Joan and Irwin Jacobs Technion Cornell Institute at Cornell Tech is located in New York City. Graduates receive dual master's degrees from the Technion and Cornell University, and that makes the Technion the first international university to grant its degree on U.S. soil. Its inaugural class convened in 2016. The Jacobs Institute is home to the Runway Startup Postdoc Program, the source of 28 startups, which have raised $66 million in private funding, and 21 patent applications, five of which have been granted. The Guangdong Technion Israel Institute of Technology is in China. It's the first Israeli university in China. It was inaugurated in December 2017, and the academic areas there focus on environmental sciences, energy resources, and human health. So I'd be remiss if I didn't talk about Technion's response to the global pandemic. At the height of the pandemic, when campus was closed, over 50 labs were open working on virus-related projects. They were given permission to be open, as it was and still is considered a matter of national security. And projects related to therapeutics, diagnostics, and PPE are still underway, and I have just a few examples to share. So Professor Hozem Hayek, who we heard about earlier, and Dr. Yoav Broza of the Technion's Wolfson Faculty of Chemical Engineering and the Russell Berry Nanotechnology Institute have devised a novel 30-second breath analyzer test to detect COVID-19. It's based on Professor Hayek's longstanding work on an artificially intelligent device for inexpensive, fast, non-invasive detection of diseases via exhaled breath. If everything goes well with further clinical studies, a technology could be available and regulated within 6 months at a cost of $2 to $3 per test. A team led by Professor Nama Geva-Zatorsky from the Ruth and Bruce Rappaport Faculty of Medicine is currently developing a home test that can rapidly diagnose the virus. The simple test does not require special lab equipment, only hot water and reagents. It produces results in less than 1 hour. Professor Eyal Zussman's Maya nanofiber sticker significantly improves the effectiveness of masks and is now being mass produced. The Technion recently reached an agreement with the Dicom paper plant in Kibbutz Ein Harod, and Dicom is turning out 5,000 stickers per day, with plans to increase production to 1 million a month. The agreement will make the sticker available to medical staff and the general public. Exclusivity agreements are already in place for Canada, Japan, and Spain. The masks are not yet available in the US. Maya has already been approved by authorities in Israel and is being fast-tracked for approval by the FDA and in the EU. Pictured are two photos from inside the Technion during the early days of the pandemic. Professor Jose Snitman and his team have developed an innovative technology that could dramatically improve the efficacy of existing drugs for treating acute respiratory distress syndrome, ARDS, which is caused by the virus. The patent-pending technology is known as liquid foam therapy and dramatically improves the distribution of surfactant across the lungs. In other words, it's a new method for pulmonary drug delivery with the potential of delivering therapeutics homogeneously into the lungs. So a little bit about the American Technion Society. We were launched in 1940 by a group of visionary entrepreneurs and scientists. There are 13 Technion societies around the world. The first one was the German Technion Society, which was founded by Albert Einstein. And today there are societies in Europe, Australia, and Asia. Our organization is based in New York City. We have regional offices around the country, and our mission is to provide philanthropic support to the Technion. To date, we've raised $2.6 billion. We try to impart the message that the Technion's achievements are made possible in large part because of our highly committed friends and donors. We have both a national board of directors and local leadership councils in each region. We host events featuring faculty and student speakers. We pivot to Zoom when necessary, as we all have learned to do. And we hope that when all is back to normal, we will see you at our in-person events featuring Technion speakers. So thank you for your time and for the invitation to speak to you this morning. You can follow the American Technion Society on social media for updates, and you can contact me. My name and email and phone are there up on the slide. We can put you on our mailing list for our local speaker events and also email updates about Technion news and innovations. And of course, when we are back in normal times, I invite you to come visit the Technion the next time you're in Israel or the Jacobs Institute on Roosevelt Island in New York City. And I'm happy to take any questions.
Yes, thank you for your presentation. It's extraordinary how much talent there is at the Technion. I had some friends that work there. My question is, how do people from other countries submit applications to either work or be students there?
So for students, it's a little bit more simple than to work there. There's an international school, so I would suggest going online to the Technion's website, and they've got their site available in a couple of different languages, and the international school would be the home for non-Israeli students. For faculty, it's a little bit more complicated. So I don't know where to begin with this. So to become a full tenured faculty member at the Technion, there's one of two criteria you need to meet. You need to be Jewish, and then you have the right of return to live and work in Israel, or you need to be Israeli or married to an Israeli. So essentially you need to be eligible for Israeli citizenship to work at the Technion as a full tenured faculty member. So it actually presents quite a challenge to the administration to recruit faculty members, because their criteria is, obviously very strong to be experts in their field. And then they have to only consider candidates who meet this Israeli citizenship potential criteria. And the other thing to know about Technion faculty is the Israel system of education is still under a socialist model, which means that faculty salaries are tiered and they're fixed throughout the different categories of university in Israel. So if you want to become a full tenured faculty member at Hebrew U or Tel Aviv U or Technion, your salary is going to be the same no matter where you go. And so these same faculty members are also being recruited by the likes of Stanford and MIT that have huge endowments that can also be much more flexible on salary for faculty. So you can see the challenges that the administration is presented with when recruiting faculty members. And one of the ways that we like to say that American Technion Society and the Technion Societies all over the world help is that philanthropic dollars can be used to recruit faculty members, in the sense that those funds can be used to help outfit labs and buy specialty equipment. You know, one microscope can be $750,000. The funds that we raise help the administration recruit faculty, because they can use that support to outfit their labs, but can't compete on salary or other things.
Thank you, Elissa. Dick Knopf? You want to unmute yourself, or please?
Thank you, Ed. Elissa, it's a pleasure having you on board with so many wonderful Jewish men. I'll put my name into the hopper for the faculty. A little bit of a joke there.
What is your area of expertise? What is your field?
I'm very good at marketing. That's a different group altogether.
Okay.
I guess my question has to do with some of the recent successes regarding COVID-19. I mean, that seems to be taking up so much of everybody's concern these days. And it looked like the breathalyzer and also the, the mass or some of the other inventions, we'll call it, are pretty far advanced. Have they yet made it into the U.S. market? And if not, why not?
So the breathalyzer, I think, is being considered for FDA approval, but has not achieved that approval. The mask is being currently mass produced in Israel, but as far as I know, there are no current plans to produce it here. And the truth is, I don't know why. I mean, I know there's a lot of red tape when these things have to get approved. I mean, essentially the mask is a sticker that increases the efficacy of a everyday surgical mask. So as you probably know, the surgical mask protects not the wearer, but the person next to the wearer. But the mask helps to protect the wearer because it is coated with a disinfectant and also provides a layer of density so that it becomes protective for the wearer to then not breathe in particles. And then if particles are inhaled, they're killed on contact by the surface of the mask that just is a disposable mask that sticks onto the surface of the disposable surgical mask.
Yeah, because the masks that we have, I mean, are pretty flimsy half the time. I got nothing against the Jewish Federation, but I ordered some masks from the Jewish Federation, and most of them don't fit. They're too big, or they don't seem to quite do the job. So anything you can do to move that along, or anything we can do to move that along and help get that through the FDA, I don't know what pull we have. We'd certainly be delighted to help out.
We're trying.
Thanks, Dick. Lee Yasker?
Question for the from American Technion Society. One is, what languages are used in the three different university campuses for students, faculty, and in lab work? And question number two, to Dick's point about our terrible masks in the US, all the masks that you can buy readily in all the stores that you might visit online or virtual or physically are called civilian masks. And they're nothing more than paper towels that are tinted and folded. They don't have special weaving and they do not have three layers, such as the very simple looking surgical masks. And ear loop masks do nothing to protect the wearer, only the people who the wearer are spitting at. You have to wear masks that band your head to create air seals around your whole face. And you can make your own by cutting up a HEPA vacuum cleaner bag and turning it into the much more effective than anything made for any store. Those are called medical grade. And when we order them, we wait 2 to 3 months to get our supplies. And that's for surgeons.
So I can address your question about the languages. So on the main Technion campus in Haifa, the undergraduate classes are conducted in Hebrew. I believe that most of the graduate classes are conducted in English, with the the knowledge being that if the graduate students and master's and PhD students want to collaborate and compete on the world stage, that they need to have a mastery of English. On the Jacobs campus on Roosevelt Island, everything is in English. Incidentally, the student body at the Jacobs campus is, not many Israelis there. They attract students from all over the United States and in fact from all over the world. So the tuition at the Jacobs campus is on the Cornell scale, where the tuition at the Technion, due to the, like I said, the education system in Israel still being under socialist model, is the equivalent of less than $5,000 a year. So it's for an MIT level education. So it's a very different, there are very different tuition scales. It attracts a different student. Also, the Jacobs campus is only a graduate school. In China, my understanding is that the classes are taught in Chinese. Incidentally, I just have an anecdotal story. A few years ago in Washington, D.C., I attended a program run by the American Jewish Committee, and it was about Israel-Asian relations. And I started talking to a young group of students from China. And, I asked them, what are you doing here? What brings you here? What are you studying in China? Tell me a little bit about yourselves. They were majoring in Hebrew. Not at the Technion campus in China, at another campus in one of the universities in China. And I said, can I ask, why would you choose such a major in China? And they said, we want to do business with Israel. Everyone in China wants to do business with Israel. So we're learning Hebrew. So that's my knowledge about the languages.
Thank you, Elissa. Anyone else? I see Ed Melman. Will you unmute yourself, Ed, please?
Anyway, I had some interest in the Chinese Guangdong campus. How did it come about? There are pretty good relationships generally between China and Israel, but was that at the initiative of the Chinese government, of the Israeli government? Where did the funding come from? Can you tell us a little bit more about it?
It was at the initiative of one Chinese entrepreneur businessman named Li Keqing. He's one of the richest men in the world. It cost the Technion not $1. He built it. He created the campus. And it benefits the Technion in a number of ways. Number one, just raising its visibility around the world, and also, I believe, helps Israel. It doesn't have a lot of friends around the world. So the more visibility in a positive light that it can garner, that doesn't hurt anyone. Like I said, it didn't cost the Technion a dollar to build. The relationship between Israel and China, I think, is one of cautious optimism. A lot of people are actually concerned that Israel's going to give away its secrets to the Chinese, who often can be perceived as not trustworthy. But the Technion ensured that the areas of academic focus on the China campus are mostly related to Chinese infrastructure and also environment and sustainability. So the major focus of academic study and research is related to, air quality, water quality. It's environmental and civil engineering and related to Chinese infrastructure. There's no aerospace engineering. There's no computer science. There's no chemical engineering. There's no electrical engineering. And that's by design.
Are the students Chinese? Are the students international?
Yes. Yes, although it does, there is, the campus was closed for quite a while. I'm not sure if it's open yet again after the virus, but it does provide channels for faculty mobility and student mobility. In particular, the faculty mobility is really critical. Israel has a mandatory retirement age of 68. That's another obstacle, by the way, in the faculty recruiting that I mentioned earlier, because every year about 30-some faculty reach a retirement age on campus. And so to maintain no growth whatsoever, 30 or more faculty members have to be replaced every year. And then, of course, the campus wants to grow. So once faculty reach retirement age, then they have options for mobility to go and work or teach at the China campus or in Roosevelt Island in New York.
Thank you, Elissa. Len Berman? You want to unmute yourself?
Elissa, what's being done to let the world know just how much Technion is doing for the world? We have a lousy human relations problem. So what's Technion doing?
Well, that's what we're here for. That's why the American Technion Society exists in part, and the societies around the world. And we're trying to elevate the Technion's presence and spread the word about all of the good that it does. And that's why we do events like this.
Is this being done in France and England and different countries around the world?
Yeah, I think there are 13 or 14 Technion societies around the world. ATS, American Technion Society, is the biggest. You have Technion Canada, Japan, Germany, UK, Australia, all over the world.
Thank you.
I don't see any more hands up. If you want to wave at me and you can't put your chat up, Larry Bernstein, I see you waving, Larry.
Yeah, hi. Hi, Elissa. It's good to see you again. I'm glad we were able to get the connection made after we met at the Philadelphia Council of Business Economics lunch. I guess it was back in January or February, pre-COVID, and you're now here to present to us. Great stuff. I had a couple of questions. As you may recall, I'm an adjunct professor of economics at Rowan. So I'm curious to know what's going on currently Technion deals with operations post-COVID or during COVID. You mentioned that they got the labs open. Are all classes now in person on campus, or is it like a hybrid model like some of the universities have here, where some classes are in person and others are going to be taught remotely for the current term?
So my understanding is that undergraduate classes are currently still remote. At the peak of the pandemic, all classes were remote. And I think some graduate students in specific labs had access to their labs. My understanding now is that I believe many or several of the graduate level classes are in person. And in terms of staffing the labs, they're kind of working on schedules of shifts so that they can maintain social distancing. So they might have a few faculty or staff members in each lab for hours during the daytime, and then someone has second shift and someone has third shift so that they can keep up their work but maintain that level of distance. Of course, when you enter campus now as a faculty member or student, your temperature is taken, you're given a questionnaire, but they also have a contact tracing system in place. When you enter a building on campus, you scan a code, a QR code on your phone, and when you leave the building, you scan a QR code. So it becomes really easy to track people down in the event that they have been exposed unknowingly. So there's not the issue of privacy for those types. I mean, that's something that would never fly on a U.S. campus, I don't think. There's no HIPAA laws in Israel either. And so they can gather data in a way that we can't here in the U.S.
and therefore run it a lot tighter. My other question is, what are Technion's growth plans, either in terms of geography or programs, areas of study that the university might initiate?
So that's an excellent question with really great timing. Last year around this time, the Technion inaugurated a new president, Professor Uri Sivan, and he has recently put out his platform of what he has stated are his goals for the university in future years. And it has to do with creating hubs of multidisciplinary faculty members working together to solve the world's problems. So the Technion kind of has a flat structure. There are 14 different faculties, which I guess in a U.S. university system, we would either call departments or colleges. Yeah. So he has 14 different deans, and each of those deans then, manage the curriculum and the faculty and the research happening within each of those faculties. And that's kind of like the European model. So what Professor or President Sivan would like to do is create more interdisciplinary hubs to bring faculty members from different faculties or departments together. And he has created three different general areas of focus. One is human health. One is advanced manufacturing, and the other is environmental sustainability. Those are his priorities.
Thanks,
Elissa. Nelson?
Elissa, thank you for being here. Nelson Mellett, that's my name. I'm curious, you said there's 20% of the students are Arabs. Do you have a breakdown of that, and particularly do you have any Arab-Palestinian students on campus?
I don't know that specifically. I can find out.
Okay, it would be a great publicity situation if you could talk about that.
Yes, I'll find out. My guess is that most of the Arab students are Arab Israeli citizens.
Okay, thank you.
Anyone else? I don't see any hands up, but if you wave at me, Dick Nemiroff, you need to unmute yourself.
I would like to ask two questions. What is the status of the Israeli vaccine?
With all of the wonderful things that are happening at the Technion with regard to COVID, I don't believe that a vaccine is a priority currently. And there are other universities and other pharmaceutical companies around the world that are working on the vaccine. As far as I know, the Technion is not.
Interesting. I was also curious about the security. I mean, regarding the opening of the Chinese facility, I'm very concerned about cybersecurity. I'm sure Israel is at the forefront of that, but this is an easy way to embed people too, who have their own cyber technology.
Right. So as I mentioned, there are people who are concerned about the relationship with China and the China campus. And, Israel is very protective of its secrets. It's not giving away the secret sauce. There is no computer science or electrical engineering education happening on the China campus.
Your presentation was excellent, and I thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone else? I don't see any wave at me or put your hand up. No one else? Elissa, thank you very much. I know everyone enjoyed it. I know we had almost 50 attendees. We very much appreciate your time and Melanie's, and look forward to innovations by Technion in the future.
Thank you. It was our pleasure to be here. Thank you so much for the invitation. Thank you to Larry for chatting with me a few months ago. It seems like a lifetime ago, but I'm so glad that we can make it work. Thank you to David and Ed and to all of you for having us today. And we hope that you'll continue to learn more about us. As I mentioned, you can find us on social media. I encourage you to visit ats.org. That's our website. And you can read more about some of the impact that the Technion has in all of these different areas that we touched on today. You can email me at Elissa. It's my first name. You can see it on the screen there, elissa@ats.org. Join our mailing list. We'd love to have all of you involved, and thank you so much for your being a great audience and for your thoughtful questions and for hosting us today.
Thank you again, Elissa. Thanks, Melanie. We're going to have a short business meeting if all you guys will stay on. If ladies, if you want to stay and hear us talk about business, you're more than welcome to stay.
I think we're going to sign off, but thank you all again.
Okay. Have a nice morning.
Thank you. You too.
Gentlemen, good morning again. I just want to bring up a few short business items. I know Don's going to want to talk about fantasy football, so why don't we let him lead off with his fantasy football. Don?
Thank you. Can you hear me okay?
Yes.
Okay, next week, next Sunday, is, believe it or not, September 6th at 10 a.m. We do have our draft. We will be trying to implement a Zoom session as well to facilitate the communication end of it. I'd just like to remind anybody who hasn't paid their dues or paid their league fee to please get that into Marty for the league fee or Stan Schumis for the membership, the $42 membership fee. But we're looking forward to an exciting season. We have 14 teams and close to 40 people involved.
Thanks, Don. We look forward to next Sunday. By the way, it's my birthday.
Oh, wow.
So I get first pick, second pick, and third pick. So I'll remind everybody again, Don just did, if you would pay your dues, about half our people have paid their dues. We need you to pay your dues, obviously. Hopefully one of these days we'll even have live meetings again. We look forward to that. Thank you for wearing your shirts this morning. I see, looks like 75 or 80% of people have their shirts on. I know that'll make Mike Perloff very happy. Mike, are you happy? Say yes.
See.
Okay. I wanted to bring up something about the food bank. We've had contact recently from the food bank. It seems that they need more people to deliver food from the food bank to the people who are dependent on the food bank. And the email that I got said that people should be available at least a few times a week. I'm going to be speaking to them probably tomorrow about volunteering for the food bank. I know I've done that in the past. I know a few of us have. I don't believe that you have to be available a few times a week. I think at this point, if you're available one time a week or two times a week, it's better than zero times a week. So if you would send me an email. I think you all have my email address from multiple emails that you get from me. Send me a note if you can help with the food bank, whether it's one time a week or two times a week. You know, it's a matter of driving down to the food bank, picking up some food, possibly one time a week, two times, whatever you want to do. I mean, it can't be too much or too few as far as I'm concerned. Send me a note. I will compile it and I will talk to Donna at the food bank and we'll get something going. They need our help. There are people who just don't have enough food. And for those of us who do, we really have to help those people out.
Is this non-contact?
This is absolutely non-contact. It's similar. I know I'm delivering food. I know Dave Schwartz has, Nelson has, I don't know who else has. But we deliver the Meals on Wheels kind of food from, and we pick it up. We drive up at Saltzman. Now, it wouldn't be at Saltzman. It'd be at the food bank. They bring the stuff out to your car. You drive to the people's house. You can put it on their front step. You ring their doorbell, or you call them on their cell phone. You back up 10 feet, 15 feet, 20 feet, whatever you want to be away from them. Hopefully they come out and pick up their food, but you absolutely do not have to have contact with people. So I feel safe with it. I don't know why anyone wouldn't feel safe with it. But in any case, if you can help, let's help. What else do I have?
Can you send your email on chat?
I can send my email on chat. If you give me a minute when we're finished, stay on. I won't end the meeting, and I will put my email again on chat. And if you would respond, that would be great. Anyone else while I, Mike, go ahead.
Yes, Nelson and I have been working on the Operation Maccabee. That's for the last 25 years, we arranged for Hanukkah cards to be sent to Jewish troops via the Jewish Welfare Board. And we started recently about 5 years ago doing it to what they call lone soldiers, which are like American children who volunteer for the IDF. And we've done that through the Lone Soldier Center in Jerusalem and Tel Aviv. Nelson, would you talk a little bit more about it? Because you've done it, you're also coordinating with the Jewish War Vets.
Yeah, thank you, Mike. Thank you, Ed. We really started around 1990 with the first Gulf War, where we started sending out thousands and thousands of cards. To date, we've been doing it almost every year. We did miss a year or two. I'd have to say we sent out over 10,000 cards and probably a lot more to the troops. Like Mike said, we already arranged with the Jewish Welfare Board and for the Israeli troops with another organization. Jewish Welfare Board sends out care packages in November this year, early November, to about 400 Jewish troops that they've identified. Of course, there's many more than 400 Jewish troops in the military, but these are the ones that are overseas, primarily in Afghanistan, in Iraq, in Kuwait, all around the Gulf area. So we're going to do it again this year. We have to work out the details about how to collect the cards. I'm hoping that the JCC actually opens up, especially the gym area. And then if that's the case, we'll set up a box in the lobby that you drop your cards in there. Just fill them out any way you want to the Israeli troops, separate cards from the US troops, and we'll get them out to the people.
Thank Nelson, you. That's just for Israeli troops, or you said something about US troops also?
Yeah, let me clarify that. Thank you, Ed. We've been doing the U.S. troops here since 1990, and we continue to do that. And that's where we're sending out thousands and thousands of cards every year to the U.S. troops. Again, we're doing U.S. troops and Israeli troops. Israeli troops, we only started about 5 years ago. That's a separate box we'll have for the Israeli troops from the U.S. troops, so we can separate the cards. But we're asking for cards for both groups of troops.
And are we supplying our own cards, or are you supplying cards for us?
You know, I can't figure out a good way to get the cards to you. We have cards.
Fill out
a blank card.
If you have cards at home, or you can buy a box of cards and address them and say something nice to the troops, then that'll be fine.
Yeah, and we're also going through the religious school kids, too, as much as we can, where they can get them. And they're really fantastic cards saying, I don't want to tell you some of the things they say. It's not appropriate. But they're very nice to the troops. Come back home safe. We really support you, especially to the Jewish troops in Israel. Yeah, Israeli troops. They're just fantastic. Thank you.
Thanks, Mike, Nelson. Lenny?
You include in a sealed envelope? Or?
By the way, don't worry about the envelopes. We're just interested in getting the cards there. And the Jewish Welfare Board, when they start packing up their 400 boxes of care packages, they just put them in there. So we even have a stamp with a return with an email address on it that they could get it and send us the troops when they get that. Send us emails and we'll get them to you too because they're fascinating.
Thank you. Lenny?
Lenny, excuse me. I want to stay on that subject for 1 second, if you don't mind, please.
Okay. Would I mind?
Of course not. Thank you. Such a gentleman. And one of the things that we were trying to think about is in collecting it, I'd like some feedback. One, we were thinking of something like if we took, let's say next Saturday or Sunday or some day during the week, we say that we'll be at the JCC parking lot and between, let's say, 1 and 3 or something. And you can bring the cards and drop them off, or if you don't have a card and don't have access to any, I think we have maybe 50 blank cards or something.
Yeah.
You can fill one out. How many people think that's a good idea or have a better way of doing it? Could you show by hand so we get a general consensus? Looks like about 5 people think it's a good idea and the rest of you don't.
Well, you know what? Mike, set it up. We'll send an email out to the membership. You'll pick a time, and you'll try it for an hour and see who shows up.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Give it a try. Lenny?
Is it possible to give some details on the program? Can you send out an email with so we have something in writing? Because I can send it out to my daughter or to other people to make up cards as well.
Sure, I'll do that. I'll draft the email, get it over to Ed.
Thank you.
Thanks, Nelson. Lenny?
I tried to drop off a shopping bag full of food at what I thought was the food bank on Route 70, and it was closed. Where is the food bank on Route 70, please?
Well, it's Jim Beach's office. There's a big sign.
It was
they're not always there. I think you probably should call before you go. I don't believe they are staffing it, 8 hours a day, 5 days a week.
All right, but it is open.
Yes. Right. Yes. I'll yes. Call. Absolutely.
Ed?
Yeah.
When you say to call, who you actually can call the food bank? You mean call the Jewish?
You can do that through the main JCC number. The I know I get to it through that number sometimes. I don't know if I have a separate number, but hang on 1 second and I'll let you know. Dick, I'll tell you what. I'll hang on 1 sec. Let's see if I can find it. If anybody else has it handy, chime in, please.
If you're going to send it out, Ed, send me a copy. Send me the number too, yeah. Please.
So if you call the main JCC number, you will get someone at the other end?
You can. There's a, there's a Rolodex on the, or whatever you want to call it, a phone list that you can access, and I think you can get food bank through that. Or you can leave a general message. I'm sure they'll get it to her if you need to. If I find the number, I'll send it out.
Okay.
In any case, but when this is over, remember I'm going to send you my email address. So if there's something you need, send me an email. I'll figure it out. Anyone else? Hands up. If wave at me, Don again. Don Weisenstein.
Okay. I just wanted to mention that I know we're not meeting, and it's unfortunate that we're not meeting, and I miss the bagels, but if you haven't paid your dues, please do so. I mean, we've had, I think, sensational programming. Even though we're not getting together, we had Sarah, we had Colonel Jacobs, we had the speaker today. David's doing a great job in getting a lot of these phenomenal speakers. And,
Thank you. Though
we're not able to get together, we're still functioning at a high level.
Thank you, Don. And David Schwartz, thank you. Time and again, wonderful speakers. I don't know how you do it, but keep it up.
You're welcome. My pleasure.
Ed, could I say something about that?
Sure, go ahead.
Okay, I was just at the virtual convention for the Jewish War Veterans, and in the closing presentation from our commander, Harvey Weiner, he mentioned the South Jersey Men's Club and the fantastic presentation they had from Jack Jacobs. Wow. He even mentioned that somebody was calling in from their hospital bed, who I think was Dave Singer. He had to actually listen to that.
Right.
So that was 300 people on the line getting more publicity about us. I was thinking about cutting in and saying, well, you could join the men's club, but no, I didn't do that. It wasn't appropriate, but we have great programming, no question.
We did get some nice publicity on the third page, well-placed of The Voice this week, a photo of Jack and a caption on the photo. And Gary Sternberg, thank you.
Very nice.
Anyone else? I wave at me, Dick Silver. You've got to, I've unmuted you, or maybe not. No, I haven't. You're going to have to unmute yourself, Dick. There you go.
Okay. All right.
Go ahead.
Actually, this isn't directly a South Jersey Men's Club subject, but I don't know, keep track of your Zoom messages. Because a lot of times you belong to an organization, these days, there's a lot of Zoom presentations. So I've been able to keep track of it because sometimes for 4 weeks in advance, you try to keep track of all your email messages and it's almost impossible to find So what I do, I take I do a copy and paste. I copy and paste the, Zoom message, the message. And I have a word processor. I use Microsoft Word. You can probably use Notepad or whatever you have. And I have it's called the Zoom presentation. That's what I call it. So I keep track of it. And anytime I have I might have one or two or more presentations a month. And I copy that, copy the presentation, and I open up my word processor and I put it in that file. And whenever I have to find it, it's easy. I just open up my word processor. I open up that one file, and it's right on there. And you just click. Most of the time, it works directly. You just click on the email location of the Zoom presentation. Keep track of the password, because sometimes they'll ask you for your password, and it'll come up. If it doesn't come up, copy and paste that presentation on the search at the top of the screen. Not the search, all kinds of searches, you know, on the computers nowadays. But the one of the, when you open your screen, at the top of the screen, when you type in your
location. In the search, in the bar at the top of the screen, yes. Yeah, thank you.
Top of the screen. And you just click it in there, you copy it, paste it in there, and it'll come up. And it's easy to find your presentation that you're looking for.
Thanks, Dick. Okay. Gentlemen, anybody else? Did Bob Greenberg, did I see? Yes, five fingers.
At least. Getting back to the food bank, weren't we able to drop off food at the JFCS entrance to the JCC building?
I don't know the answer to that.
Because they were actively requesting people, you know, shop and drop.
Monday morning, 9 to 12.
Right. So it's over at the JFCS. So Len, you can just drop it off right at the JFCS entrance.
Oh, good. That's great to know.
And hey Bob, I think you have to call them. And I thought that was a temporary thing for whatever month it was. But
Monday morning, 9 to 12.
Is that every Monday?
Gloria?
No.
No. But this Monday.
This Monday.
Call the JFCS number. She'll call you back. And I know, because I'm dropping off some food, that she's going to be there Monday from 9 to 12. They're not there all the time anymore because of COVID.
Okay. And that's
this Monday, they're all
side of the building?
Yeah, that's the JFCS side.
That's the on the side of the building to the left. Okay, thank you.
Anyone else?
Yeah.
I just left my email address in the chat. If before you get off the meeting, I won't close the meeting out for a couple minutes, is my email address. If you have a question or need something, you want to participate in delivering food from the food bank, especially those people, I'd like to get your names because I want to talk to them tomorrow about integrating us in their schedule. Anyone else? Hands up, waving, Dick Knopf waving.
Yeah, there's no investment club meeting, I guess. I don't see Odd Court at our meeting, so I guess
I don't see him
we'll
either.
Try to do something during the month of September.
How much Tesla do you have, and when are you going to sell it?
Why sell it?
Who said that?
That's what my son says. I think he's ready to retire now.
Well, Amazon is doing nicely, too.
Absolutely. Anybody else? Gentlemen, have a nice day, a nice week.
Email address, Ed.
Looks like the weather today is as good as it's going to get for a while, so enjoy your day.
Yep.
Thank you.
Thanks, Ed.
Thanks all for attending. I think we had close to 50 this morning, so that's a nice attendance. Thank you.
Lewis Aaron, Mother Station.
Bye-bye.
Nice job, David.
Bye-bye, everybody.
Get you a check.
Bye, guys.
All right, I'm going to leave it open for a few minutes. If you want, you can leave, and I won't end the meeting. If you want to go to chat, you can ask me a question. You can get my email address, whatever.
Got it. Scott, it's in his, he sent you a chat with his email.
I got it.
Okay.
You like Randy, my background?
Randy, I'm going to say something. Randy, thank you for all your messages. I'm sorry that I wake you up all the time, and but I appreciate your help.
Don't call until afternoon.
Midnight works.
Randy's asleep most of the day. You just have to wake him up.
You like my background?
Yes, very nice. Very nice.
Oh, hey, Michael,
David Nydorf, thank you for getting everything onto the website.
Is he here?
He's here. He's in my top left-hand corner. I don't know where he is on your screen, but he's here.
There he is. Oh, hi, David. How you doing, buddy?
Doing well.
And for the first time in quite a while, he stayed awake the whole time.
Yeah, right.
Oh, my.
Usually, nights off.
Oh, my.
Perfect day to bike.
Mm-hmm. It's a good background, Dave.
Is Marty still on?
Hey, Jerry.
Yeah, don't drown.
For those of you who didn't see the email.
Can I ask a question?
Sure. Who's that?
It's Jerry Mitzner.
Okay, Jerry Mitzner, go ahead.
With whom do I communicate about paying my bill?
Our website.
You pay it on the website.
Pay it on the website. Put it on your credit card. You'll get points and miles and all kinds of stuff.
Lucky me.